responsive reading. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let's stay standing in prayer. Almighty God, we have gathered as reflective but grateful people to recall the events which happened on Calvary, that first Good Friday. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit to enlighten us, to lead us to see and to remember always that Jesus was on the cross in our place, and he suffered so that we would not have to die for our sins. Help us to love you more and more and to show our love by following Jesus' footsteps, gladly doing those things which are pleasing to you. We pray this in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please stay standing to sing the two verses of the song, Hail, O Once Rejected Jesus. Christ's words are for and to us. Yes, Jesus died for the sins of those who crucified him, but also for our sins. In the words of the old hymn, he was brought to Pilate for judgment. he was sentenced to hang on a tree. "It is finished," he cried, when he suffered and died to save a poor sinner like me.
When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Luke 23:33-34. The first words of Christ come in the form of a prayer, the call of a son to a father. Tradition has it that Jesus spoke these words as the soldiers drove the nails through his hands. Even as they inflicted wounds on his already beaten and bloody body, Jesus cried out, not on his behalf, but on their behalf. Around the cross, spectators hurled verbal stones at a dying man. Not satisfied with just impaling him with nails, they now drive their words deep into his soul. Proverbs tells us, reckless words pierce like a sword. And James adds that the tongue is an uncontrollable evil, full of deadly poison. How many of us have felt the sting of a harsh word and struck back hard? Yet Jesus did the opposite. Instead of shouting down at them, Christ spoke up. He prayed. He still prays. Even today, he intercedes for us. How easily, though, we hold on to grudges and speak ill of those who wrong us. How unlike Jesus we can be. One wonders if any nearby recall Jesus' answer to the question of how many times should I forgive my brother. I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Here at the cross, Jesus gives us the ultimate example of forgiveness. Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. Lord Jesus, through your death, you give us life.
Thank you. mocked insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you'll be with me in paradise." The cry of Hosanna, "Save us now," had become, "Crucify him." Now, milling about the cross are those mourning the death of Jesus, those there to see justice done, those there mocking and railing against him. Yet, a lone voice sounds a different tone. "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Who said that? Who dare utter such blasphemy? Was it John, who was standing nearby? Was it perhaps one of the secret disciples among the Sanhedrin? It was none of these. The words come from an unlikely source. There on a cross, next to Jesus, hangs a man deserving of death, a thief, a brigand. From out of the depths of agony comes a plea. "Remember me." What does Jesus feel as he hears those words? Through all the mocking and scoffing, through the sobbing and screaming, one voice, "Remember me." The first person admitted into paradise is not a pious priest nor a prominent prophet. It is the lowest of sinners, a criminal sentenced to death on a cross. Long ago, God's heart broke as he ushered his beloved children out of paradise into a fallen world. In his second word from the cross, Jesus cracks open the door to the garden of God's presence and lets one sinner in. We see here the supreme example of being saved not by works but by grace. What did the robber do to deserve a ticket to heaven? Nothing. What great ministry would he embark upon? None. How many people would he witness to? Zero. Yet today, there is a grinning ex-con walking the golden streets who knows more about grace than 1,000 theologians. The great Polish astronomer, Copernicus, one of the greatest minds of his time, had written on his grave, "Lord, I do not ask the kindness which thou didst show to Peter. I do not dare ask the grace thou didst grant to Paul. But Lord, the mercy thou didst show to that dying robber, that mercy show to me that earnestly I crave." The words to the thief on the cross remind us that no matter how far we have fallen, no matter how late the hour, no matter what we can offer the King of grace and mercy, await all those who ask, "Jesus, remember me." Lord Jesus, through your death, you give us life.
Remember me, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom.
You. near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciples whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son," and to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. John 19:25-27. Simeon once whispered to Mary, "A sword will pierce your heart," and here it was, a sword more sharp and striking more deeply than Mary could have possibly imagined. How many times? It's hard for me to have a son. How many times has she soothed the cuts and scrapes of the boy Jesus? How many times has she given her son comfort? Now she stands by helpless, unable to even offer a cooling cloth to bring relief from the heat of the day. John alone tells us, near the cross of Jesus stood his mother. Where else would she be? Where else could she be? This was her son. His were the herbs that brought comfort when Joseph was laid to rest. No one else on the hilltop that day, save Jesus, felt greater anguish or greater pain. The Mark Lowry Buddy Green song says, "Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This Christ that you delivered will soon deliver you." It has been noted that Jesus turns his attention to Mary as the soldiers argue, then cast lots for the final article of his clothing, the seamless undergarment. According to tradition, this article is given to a son by a mother when he reaches manhood. Now, as the soldiers haggle over who gets these pieces of clothing, sewn by his own mother's hands, Jesus seeks to bring her comfort. Jesus' words of comfort remind us that none of us need to be alone, that through his death and resurrection, we have all become sons and daughters. We have all become someone's mothers and fathers. Take this opportunity to look around in the growing darkness and know that you are never alone. You are part of God's family. Dear woman, here is your son, here is your mother. Lord Jesus, through your death, you give us life.
Suddenly knows loneliness. It is almost more than he can bear. But then, it is not evil. Is that not what sin does? Sin casts us adrift from God. Sin leaves us shipwrecked, orphaned, and abandoned. On the Day of Atonement, a young spotless goat was brought before the high priest. The priest would lay his hands upon the goat, and all the anger, filth, hatred, lust, greed, everything impure would be transferred to the goat, called the scapegoat. He would then be carried out to the edge of the camp and released into the wilderness, alone. Hanging on the cross, Jesus became sin, and the Father turned his face away. Jesus experienced a taste of hell, a taste of what it is like to be separated from God. On this side of the cross, we need never know a place, a time, a circumstance when God is far from us. Because of the cross, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, not any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Need never be uttered by us, because Jesus was willing to die a shameful death on the cross. Lord Jesus, through your death you gave us life.
Jesus as the minutes became hours? Or was it Psalm 42? As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul longs after you. Is there not a touch of irony in that the one who could hold the oceans in the palm of his hand now thirsts? John Donne wrote, "'Twas much that man was made like God before, but that God should be made like man much more." Can we ever fathom the wonder of the Word becoming flesh? Surely we can see here that Jesus is fully human, experiencing one of the most basic needs, thirst. Water is life. Yet why say anything? He knew he was dying, and that a simple drink would not change the outcome. Perhaps he just wanted to be able to utter his final words with clarity. Jesus has now been on the cross for almost 6 hours. His lips are now dry and cracked, perhaps even bleeding. His tongue has swollen, and his throat is parched from drawing in breath in great gasps. Whatever the reason, because Jesus experienced this thirst, we need never thirst again. We can have living water that quenches the thirst of our souls, living water that brings eternal life. As the psalm says, there is a river that flows from deep within. There is a fountain that frees the souls from sin. Come to the water, there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. Lord Jesus, through your death, you gave us life.
Down
a triumphant fish would have punched in the dark sky, the penalty for our sins, paid in full. The depth of our transgressions, paid in full. The cost of our salvation, paid in full. Peter reminds us that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors, and the ransom he paid was not mere gold or silver. He paid for you with the precious lifeblood of Christ, the sin, the spotless Lamb of God. Peter 1:18. It is finished. Lord Jesus, through your death, you gave us life.
Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. Luke, verse 23, chapter 46. These last words of Jesus from the cross put an exclamation point on the fact that his life wasn't taken as much as it was given. Here, even at the cross, we see that Jesus was in control, that nothing happened without his allowing it to happen. After the mournful cry of desolation, when he sensed the Father turning away, Jesus knew where he was going and to whom he could call out to. It had been a short road. Only 3 years had passed since he hung up his carpenter's apron and said his goodbyes. He had experienced hunger, weariness, grief, thirst. Jesus knew what it was like to have the sun beat down upon sweaty skin and to pull the blankets up a little bit higher during those chilly nights. Now, at the end of the journey, his work all completed, he knows home is just a heartbeat away. These words were issued for our benefit, not to assure us that, or to assure us that when the darkness creeps over our lives and we're in greatest despair, there is still a Father that we can entrust our spirit to. But we need not wait until a moment of anguish, a moment when we experience that dark night of the soul. This final word of Christ, spoken as a prayer, can also be our daily prayer. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Lord Jesus, through your death, you give us life.
I am crucified with Christ, therefore I no longer live. Jesus Christ now lives in me. I am crucified with Christ, therefore I no longer live. Jesus Christ now lives in me. I am crucified with Christ, therefore I no longer live. Jesus Christ now lives in me. I am crucified with Christ, therefore I no longer live. Jesus Christ now lives.
Was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Surely he took up our infirmities. But he was pierced for our transgressions. he was crushed. For our iniquities, the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Men of sorrows have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Ascended and glorified Savior Jesus Christ.